this time, we have a panel that will answer any questions about the movie. I am moderating. I can also answer some questions. But we have Ramsey Denison, the director, and Randy Wiles, the director. Thank you all for coming. So I will be calling on anyone who would like to ask a question, and if you'll come up to the microphone, that would be great. Would anybody like to ask a question?
You're a son of all of us, right? Where is Sunday from?
To not let that happen. Don't let the bad guy win again.
Yeah, Hey, can I just stop for 1 second? We'd like to invite another panelist up. Could you please stop? Neill Franklin is a representative of law enforcement, is that correct?
Yes.
Yes, and he is here as well. And so please welcome Neill Franklin as well. Is David Zababian here? Okay, David, please come up as well. I shouldn't have done this, but I'm so sorry. Just a little disagreement. And do we have a question here, sir?
I'd just like to make a comment. I've been a resident since 1961, and this is a long time coming. I also filed a lawsuit against the Las Vegas Metro and found that they didn't ever succeed suing this police department. We had a lieutenant Spinoza years ago. He was at head of the internal affairs.
We're here to talk about this film. It's not the story for anything else. So if you have a question, we'd really
appreciate it. I have a wealth of information. I've tried to contact you via email, via the Facebook. I have a wealth of information. I have a lot of knowledge relevant to this film, and I hope you'll come. John
Thank you. Would the panelists like to say anything? If they'd like to say anything, we'd love to hear from you before we answer the question. And just so everybody knows, this is a question and answer time. This is not a time to bring up other cases or anything. So, but panelists, would you like to say something? Yeah, please introduce yourself even more than your name.
I'm Ramsey Denison. I'm the director of What Happened in Vegas.
I'm David Sabian. I'm the deputy director for the Center for Criminal Justice Reform, which is part of the American Conservative Union in Washington, D.C.
And my name is Randy Wiles.
Neill Franklin. I am a 34-year law enforcement veteran from the state of Maryland. I'm the current executive director of the Law Enforcement Action Partnership, known as LEAP. And just so you know, our organization is an organization of police, judges, prosecutors, criminal justice professionals who advocate for dramatic reform, change, elimination of many of the problematic public policies that we have in place that lead, unfortunately, to the making of films such as this. We need drastic reform within our policing community, within our entire criminal justice community. And as it relates to policing, we need civilian-led policing in this country.
Are there any other prepared statements that you'd like to say before we reach into questions? Okay, thank you. Ma'am, please.
Hi, everybody. I'm born in Las Vegas. This is one of my respect police officers. I love the film. I have a very simple question. Who made it, and how long did it take you to make it? And who received funding for this film?
So I began the movie in August of 2013. So, as you can see from the movie, this is a situation where I literally called 911 to report police brutality on officers, and next thing you know, the officers that I reported were beating me up and stomping on my head. And I went to internal affairs, and they decided that was acceptable conduct. And that's when I started making the movie, because it was clear that they could not police their own. They weren't interested in policing their own. And what they were really interested in is protecting their own. And that's what the LVMPD does best. As Rhonda said in the film, serve and protect, they serve and protect their own. They certainly do. They certainly do.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
I'm Cameron, all of Las Vegas. What was absent in the film, but I'm sure you guys probably investigated, was the inquest process, which is going away, and now the DA that investigates officer involved deaths. If you could just speak about the experience from making the movie, the old process, whether the new process is, I guess, a system in place for accountability, or there is a system, of your thoughts and feelings about that process and what can be done.
Can I answer that? I'd like to answer that, because I've had a conversation with District Attorney Wolfson about this accountability process. He has taken the firm position that he will not investigate or even listen to any case that isn't first vetted by and submitted by the Las Vegas Metropolitan Police Department. That is his system. That is what he's done. This last legislative session, we tried to push forward a very, very simple amendment to some laws that just simply said that any attorney, any officer of the court, could present evidence for the district attorney to make the decision. This doesn't take away from the district attorney. Either we trust him or we don't. But all we wanted to do is make it so that anybody else could submit facts and evidence to the district attorney and the Las Vegas Police Protective Association came very strong against that, and we were shouted down, and it didn't even get to anybody. So we do believe that there needs to be, or I believe personally, there needs to be accountability. But the fact of the matter is, they changed the process, okay. They changed the process so the district attorney makes the decision. But the fact of the matter is, he wasn't going to listen to anything or look at any evidence that isn't presented to him by the police. So, thank you very much. Does that answer your question? All right, thank you. Yes, sir.
Hi, I'm Leslie Yule from the Las Vegas Review Journal. I'm going to keep a question to the film. I was wondering if there were any cases you looked into that didn't make the movie, and for the other panelists, if there are any cases you thought sort of might rise to the same level.
That's a good question. I mean, we actually had other cases in the film at a certain point, and it just became, filmmaking is actually fairly practical sometimes. Like, cost issues for the person that you're trying to get the footage from is difficult. And so, there was a case where we had, that we examined well, and it just became, like, the footage that we were using, the person was too difficult, so we ended up, like, cutting that person out of the movie. Because it was just too difficult to do. So yeah, there were a couple, and there were other cases too. We wanted to keep the movie around 90 minutes, but we weren't able to examine even though they were very interesting. I mean, the LVMPD, I could probably make a 6-hour movie about this organization. I mean, the corruption runs that deep, but you just only have time for a certain number of cases.
And we'd love to talk to you about some other cases later. We certainly can contact them. We can let you know about it. Are there any other questions?
Yes, sir.
Please.
Personally, I feel that they're getting away with it. murder on a consistent basis. So it's like this to me. If they're getting away with murder on a consistent basis, I think something needs to be done as far as more hardcore. Let's shut this down. Now, you said that you don't believe in this and that, but I don't believe that these police officers should be getting away with murder, especially in the black community.
Right on, brother.
But first, baby steps. How about maybe they get suspended or maybe lose their jobs? I mean, that's.
How about we start putting them in prison where they belong?
Yeah, I think there's that too.
That's what I like.
But nothing, nothing is.
Cunningham belongs in prison.
I agree with you. But my point is, nothing is happening. Nothing is happening, and the police investigator himself and say there was nothing. That's a problem.
Yep, that was the problem I ran into.
Yes, sir.
All right, my name is Trevon Cole. I'm a supervisor of information.
My name is Trevon Cole. I'm a supervisor of information from an local organization out here called All Shades United. My question is, actually, you just walked me into it when you were talking about maybe we should, you know, get the suspensions and take these little tokenisms, but they're taking lives, and it's how do we, you know, how do we just accept them taking a life with, in terms of police terrorism? They took Tashii's life. They just took Anthony Barron's life, a 16-year-old that they're trying to say committed suicide. He didn't commit suicide. Look into the story. But what I'm asking is involuntary manslaughter? I mean, it's nothing compared to what any of us would get, like Brother Jay Jackson was saying. So how do we apply the pressure to continue to get that? And I ask that for anyone who's representative of law enforcement or anyone who has an answer to that, because I feel like they just give us these scraps, you know, oh, here, he was strong, he's fine. And it continues to happen.
Yeah, yes, sir. I think Mr. Franklin's probably the person, and Mr. Savoy?
Let me
I'm sorry about that.
Do you know what civilian-led policing is? Maybe I need to ask that question first. Does anyone know what it is? Let me explain what it is. The police belong to you. They work for you. They are to serve you. But yet, we in this country do not control our police departments because that's not how the process is set up. We talk about civilian review boards. Even when they work, they don't work. And it's after the fact. Here's what civilian-led policing is. To have the community that sets the philosophy, that dictates what is important to the community as it relates to police going about their business. You set the budget. You hire and fire the police through a committee that represents the community. Community leaders, youth leaders, clergy, that who make up the community. You are in charge of the police. Setting the philosophy, calling the shots, and when things don't go the way you want them to go, you make changes. Not the mayor, not the city manager, not the governor, you the community. And that's where we need to go. And the only way we can do that is if and when you organize as a community to insist.
I work for an inherently policy-oriented organization, someone called Political. And it seems to me, speaking for myself and on behalf of my organization, that the challenge you face is that when all you have is a hammer, everything looks like a nail. Right? What we have is we've got a system where there is a lack of transparency and accountability, and you don't have the tools to enforce and pursue that. And civilian-led policing is a great concept. How you execute it is the challenge. And I think that challenge has to be taken up at the ballot box. And unfortunately, Larry Burns didn't make it the last go-round. And to the extent, and I don't know if Nevada has the ability to put things on ballot initiative authority. But you take it to the ballot and you put it to the voters and you make structural changes through the political process. You know, the gentleman came up and talked about death penalty for police officers. I'm a skeptic of government writ large. I don't think the government does a great job of just about anything. And so the idea of empowering the government to make decisions about life or death scares the living daylights. I don't think you can take a position of singling out any specific groups. I know that some have been singled out because of culture and bias and a whole assorted list of excuses, and that's what it is, it's pure excuse. But the approach that Larry has taken, you look at how community policing is supposed to work across the country, and it does work when it's implemented. And so the challenge Nevada and Las Vegas in particular has is to identify those leaders who work twice as hard so that there's not an 8,000 vote difference come election day. And so we do have the type of people that are your leaders and are accountable to you as the voters. That's the only way I see that you can get out of this trick bag, for lack of a better term, because the power structure is such that it resists change. And the only way to make that change happen is really through organization at the ballot box and on constitutional and ballot issues.
Thank you. Now, I've been told that we have 3 minutes left.
Everybody, everybody, everybody.